of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King of all.
Welcome to worship. Whether this is your first time with us or you're here week after week, we hope that this service is a blessing to you. Let us pray. Gracious God, quiet our minds, still our hearts, open us up to your presence, and bless us now as we pause for a moment to listen and reflect and be drawn closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Darkness, longing for truth, we we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in
Gospel reading for today is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. The Gospel of our Lord. I invite you to pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you that you came down, that you walked in our midst, and that you answered the question that we all hold in our heart: what have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Amen. Have you ever had important questions that you needed to ask? I know I have. Throughout all of my years of schooling, each progressive year, I encountered conundrums, words, or dilemmas that I didn't know the answer to and needed someone to help me. From trying to remember as a five-year-old what that lopsided shape with four sides was called, I knew it wasn't a square, to years later sitting in one of my first classes in seminary and listening to my professor mention the word exegesis over and over again. I have had questions that I needed answered. By the way, my first question's answer is rhombus, and exegesis means to critically explain or interpret a text or biblical scripture. So a pretty important process to learn for a person called to be a pastor, his exegesis. Of course, important questions don't exist simply in the context of school or scholastic learning, do they? No, they're important questions throughout life. From the owner of a new iPhone 12 not knowing how to get the best out of their new phone's camera, to the high school boy wanting to ask the girl he has a crush on whether she likes him or are they just friends. That last question leads into the realm of human relationships, both personal and communal, and the questions that so badly need answers, those of motive. Questions like, what are you hoping for in our relationship? Or, why do you want to be our leader? In today's scripture, the unclean spirit, who confronted Jesus in the synagogue, asked a question. Actually, two questions of Jesus. Important questions, questions that needed answers. The first question the spirit asked was, I think, a question that many people wanted to ask Jesus then and in the years to follow. In fact, I think it's a question that people in some form still ask today, which is, what have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have not people over the centuries, through the millennia, wondered that same thing? Jesus, what have you to do with us? It's an important question, right? In other words, the question inquires, what are you about? Why have you come? What or who do you care about? And some, perhaps many, have then asked the second question, have you come to destroy us? Meaning, have you only come, Jesus, so as to condemn me to hell? Have you come to earth simply to destroy me for my failings? Jesus, what have you to do with me? Well, these questions the unclean spirit asked are actually good questions that all of us need answers to. For what does Jesus have to do with me? What does Jesus have to do with you? For starters, many people do think Jesus is all about judgment and condemnation. Much of the world perceives Jesus' people, us Christians, to be about those very same things. And so they logically assume that Jesus has come to judge and condemn them. In other words, they concentrate upon the unclean spirit's second question. They do not understand that for us, God's beloved children, the question concerning destruction is really a false question, for it comes from fear. Rather, it's the first question that is important, that leads somewhere. For it's open-ended, the first question is the question whose answer bears exploring. So let us remember where Jesus was and what he was doing when the unclean spirit revealed itself and the questions were asked. Jesus was in a synagogue, teaching. Yet there was something different about Jesus' teaching. The Bible says they were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority. And again later, what is this, a new teaching with authority? Isn't that interesting? The reactions of the people are focused upon Jesus' presence, which holds authority. They hear it first in his teachings, and then they see effects of his authority, his spiritual authority, over the unclean spirit. Again and again, we read of how people are struck by Jesus' powerful teaching and preaching. His presence and manner of teaching commands respect because what he teaches is unlike anything else they have heard, unlike the teachings of those they normally listen to, the scribes and Pharisees. Jesus speaks with a clarity and power that they've never encountered before. Jesus does not just recount the law, but rather he informs his listeners why the law was given and for whom. God's people. Remember the power of Jesus' parables? From the Good Samaritan to the prodigal son to the gracious landowner, Jesus teaches the people something new about God. Jesus teaches them that God loves them and his gracious forgiveness is what redeems them. He tells them that God gives to them life and wants them to live fully in it. In these parables, we start to see an answer to the question of, what has Jesus to do with us? But more than Jesus' words, it is in Jesus' powerful actions of love and grace, actions that change people's very lives, that the answer comes to clarity. In the synagogue that day, when Jesus frees the man from the unclean spirit, he gives to him new life. Jesus didn't come to destroy the man, but rather the forces that oppressed him. What Jesus had to do with the man was to give him life, to free him from death. And this is what Jesus wanted to do for all of the people who came to listen to and follow him. He was willing to take on the demons, the false prophets, the weak scribes, the self-righteous Pharisees, the self-seeking priests, and yes, the oppressive and deadly Romans. Jesus was willing to stand up and speak for the people, and more importantly, to and with the people, that they might come to know and understand the truth. He wanted them to understand the answer to the question the unclean spirit asked in the synagogue. Jesus wanted every person to know that he was there for them, offering them something new and something fresh. Jesus was offering every person new life in his love and forgiveness. And this is the answer to the unclean spirit's question. This is what Jesus has to do with us. Jesus gives us what we cannot earn. Jesus gives us life, new life, with his never-ending, grace-filled love. All of Jesus' miracles, all of his healings, and all of his teachings point to life. What Jesus wants to do with us is simple. Jesus wants to love us. It is in our relationship of faith that we come to understand the power and awe of God's great love. Jesus shows us that love by dying for our sins on the cross and then rising to new life on the third day. So you never need to question Jesus about what he has to do with you, for love is the answer to that question. You, yes, you are the apple of God's eye. You are at the center of God's heart, for Jesus loves you no matter what. So rejoice in his love. Amen.
What can I give to you? What can I offer to the King for all of the love he's shown? For all of your mercy over me. When I call your name, you heard my cry. Out of the grave and into life, my heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Rock of salvation, my hope is built on nothing less. Morning by morning, how great is your faithfulness. When I call your name, you heard my cry. Loud out of the grave and into life, my heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Suffered once for all. of the grave and into life. My heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me.
Let us pray. Gracious God, today, the man who is possessed asked, Lord, what will you have to do with us? Lord, sometimes we wonder the same thing. What would you have to do with us? And we worry sometimes that we aren't good enough, or you may be coming to punish us, or that's really what we deserve. But Lord, help us to hear your word today that says you have come to bring life and health, restoration and wholeness. Lord, we need this so much in our world and in our lives. Lord, help us believe that you are work bringing those things. We ask it in Jesus' name. And then, Lord, look upon those who are in special need. We pray today especially for all those suffering in body, mind, or spirit. We ask for your presence with David Thuy, with Roger and Joyce, and all those, Lord, who are still recovering from COVID, all those impacted by cancer. We ask, Lord, for a restoration of health and wholeness, whether it be from physical illness or from depression or from economic stress. Lord, restore your people and bring life. We give you thanks today, Lord, for the church council and this last year of ministry here at Our Saviour's. We especially give you thanks for Pat O'Connor and Gerald Olson and the sharing of their gifts with us as they lead the church council. We ask that you would continue to bless their ministry in other ways in this place. Lord, we continue to lift up to you our country and ask for your healing of our divisions and the restoration of our peace and economic prosperity, an end to this pandemic. Help us, Lord, in the midst of our weariness with the pandemic to do the things that are helpful and necessary to keep it at bay. And Lord, we ask that you would be with those who are, especially those who are impacted financially. Continue to help us find the ways we can at this time to be your heart, hands, and feet in the world. Help us to be of service and to have a service mindset. Lord, you know the things that we need. Come now and bless us. We ask that you would bless our annual meeting today and our continued work here. All these things and whatever else you see we need, we ask it in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Well, today we're celebrating Pat O'Connor and Jarl Olson and the gifts that they had to share with us on the church council. They're finishing their terms, and we want to thank them for the sharing of their gifts and the time that they spent, their leadership and their contributions. And thank you for all the ways that you continue to support us in ministry here at Our Saviour's. So I have one announcement today, and that's simply regarding our annual meeting. You should have received a link. A link went out at 9:30 a.m. this morning, and the annual meeting will be happening at 10:30, both in person and online and calling in, whichever way that works for you. Please join us if you are, you're watching this before the annual meeting takes place. Thank you for your contribution in helping us run our congregation and making this a wonderful place to do ministry. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.